There's nine of us in the family. I have five sisters and three other brothers. My pop was a factory worker. And my mom, after most of the siblings were in school, she got a part-time job at a hospital, being like what they call like a nursing assistant. February 15th, 1966, I enlisted in the service, something that I wanted to do. Basically my first trip, you know, going away from home, so you know, that was an experience. I remember getting somewhat excited when they announced that we're our final approach, you know, to Saigon in Vietnam. And they open up the back of the plane and like a big rush of hot, humid air. It's, you know, kind of caught you off guard and had an odor to it. I remember just being uneasy for a while, looking and smelling and, you know, I'm here. I'm glad I'm here. But there's a part of me that was saying that, you know, I wasn't, so I don't know.
Gary Wetzel arrived in Vietnam and was assigned to an ordnance outfit that supplied various convoys with ammunition. But wanting to be a gunner on a helicopter, he re-enlisted for 3 years in order to have his choice of duty stations. On January 8, 1968, after serving 2 years and taking part in various operations, Wetzel and his unit were completing routine search flights when four Australian Allied helicopters that had come under heavy fire nearby arrived at their base camp.
Four helicopters come in, Australian choppers, they just came in and they were just tore up. So their people were talking with our people, discussing where it happened, which is about a click away. They put together some form of an operation. The Australians joined us, so we had, you know, 10 American helicopters and four Australians. Well, we're making our approach, and normally when you're coming in with the slicks, you know, the choppers, you have the first set of gunships that prep the LZ, and then the second set of guns are about 100 yards in front of you. Well, we're getting closer, it's like, where's these gunships? Come on, boys, you know. And I look out the chopper and the gunships are about a quarter mile behind us. Right then and there, you know, it's, you know, it's a big goddamn mistake. We get about treetop level, we're coming in, we're committed. And then must have been 8 million of them stood up. I mean, not that many, but then we get hit in the left front. The RPG, it's a, what they call a rocket propelled grenade, blows the front of the ship out. And we finally come to a skidding halt. The crossfire is horrendous. Timmy, my aircraft commander, he got hit like, say, from here down. It was nothing but chop me, just. And then my crew chief, Bart, was coming in over the radio pedestals. We unsnapped Timmy to get him on the other side. We figured it was safer on the other side of the ship for some reason. And we got him about halfway up, and then Bart says, duck. He goes like this, and I hear a bang. Kind of threw me next to the seat. I was hanging on here, and then I'm out here, and this part of my arm is hanging straight down here. And then I yelled real loud, and I look over to my left, and I see this VC is gonna take another grenade, he's gonna throw it, but I had my Thompson, so then I pulled the trigger and zippered him up, and then he fell back, and then heard a big explosion. I was happy for that because I figured I got, you know, some more of his buddies. I turned back to Timmy. Bart and I put tourniquets on his legs that stopped the bleeding. And grab him and slide him across the rice paddy towards the rice dike. At least get him on an angle, keep his head out of the water. And I figured I got a little bit more zip left in me, so I, you know, grabbed the Thompson. I kind of low crawled around the front of the ship, and there's six of them. And they were trying to take my 60 off, my machine gun. I yell at them, they look at me, and I pull the trigger, eliminated that. I went back by Timmy, and he kept telling Bart and myself, he'd say, tell Jane I love her, which is his wife. I'm like, shut up, you tell her yourself, we'll get out of this shit, you know. And like I said, we got Timmy here in my arm, and he looks up and he says, tell Jane. And then at that time, I thought he died. You don't have a chance to get emotional, cry, sad, whatever. You have to react. So I figured I want to get a few more of these sons of bitches. I took my hand and I tucked inside my belt so it wouldn't flap around. And I tell everybody I do what I call my John Wayne run and start going back towards my chopper because I know that's where my 60 is. And the bullets are zinging, zinging, zinging. Sometimes you figure they're going right through you. And then I got nailed in the leg, and I remember being down on one knee. But from that point to the next thing I remember, I'm in my gunwale. How I got there, I don't know. And I'm like, come on, you sons of bitches, come get me. Here I am. And figure this is my last hoorah. Let's go.
Although bleeding profusely from the loss of his left arm, Wetzel took the enemy under fire. He remained at his position until he had eliminated the automatic weapons emplacement that had been endangering the lives of his men.
Later on, when we were trying to survive, I would grab guys by the shoulder and slide them across the mud net to the medic so he could work on them. I passed out at various different times, and some people say, you know, there's a lot that I pull out. I don't know. I was busy. I wasn't counting. And a lot of death that day. A lot of death. And life goes on.
Gary Wetzel spent 6 months in the hospital and was discharged at the end of June. He was working at a new job when a colonel, major, and first sergeant paid him a visit.
They told me I had to go see this liaison, but they said it's something important. I'm like, yeah, I gave you an arm. What else do you need, you know? But it took them about 10 days to convince me I was going to go down and receive the Medal of Honor. And it was the trip. They told us that the president's going to look at you, and you look right back at him, show him you got guts. It's like, okay. And I did. And, very, very special. Since then, I've met 9 presidents. Been to 6 presidential inaugurations. We tend to look at the red, white, and blue, and oh, there's a flag, but I see into the flag. I see beyond the flag. I see before what the people did, men and women, for us to be here right now.